I can't live up to that, I'm sorry. I thank you very much. In fact, the thing that impressed me the most about what Cheyenne said, she said it this morning, the most important people here today are you. I'm very impressed, I'm very honored to be speaking to you today because you're very rare, or at least rare. You're taking your Saturday to come to a place like this, not to learn more about your specialty or to, you know, to get more facts, but to try to understand this insanity. And this is an insanity. We all know that. And the question that I ask myself is how we got there, what's causing the insanity, and how can we get out? The part that I'm going to deal with is the electronic medical records, but I've heard these brilliant discussions this morning from Dean Cleary, Dr. Rosenthal, amazing, just brilliant discussions. And I hope to be able to add my bit, although I'm nowhere near as much of an expert as Cheyenne claims. Anyways, let's see if I know how to use this because I don't give too many. This is the problem. And by the way, to most of you will be funny, to some of you won't be funny at all, I'm sorry. It's real though, right? This is what we will be talking about today. And if you don't like this joke, I have others. Doctor and physician are outdated terms. I'm your biological tech support specialist. I mean, if our foreparents, physicians, were to come to Earth today and they're resuscitated, they would have said that we went out of our minds. And believe me, we have. And the question is why? And if you don't like when I have this one, this one is really good. Actually, I'm not a doctor, I'm a healthcare administrator. That's okay, I'm not the patient, I'm his attorney. This is the best one and the worst one. What my friends think I do, what my mom thinks I do, what society thinks I do, what Hollywood thinks I do, what patients think I do, and what I really do. This is the latest electronic healthcare record switch survey. Now, why do they call it a switch survey? From the American Academy of Family Physicians. Are there any members of the AFP here? Yeah, there are a few. One of the largest medical societies in the world, 119,000 members. They do this study every 2 years. What happened was doctors began to switch EMRs. I mean, we know that, right? And when they did that, only 43% agreed, and by the way, I used the word EMR, it wasn't an accident, we'll talk about that. Only 43% agreed or strongly agreed that they're happy that they changed their EHR systems, which means the other 60% went from bad to worse. And then this verbatim comments indicated for many respondents the EHR change was mandated by their administrators. Now this is a fascinating problem, okay? And I love the fact that we're all here together because the fact is the answer is in this room. But what's interesting is the answer is not with any one of us in the room, but with all of us together. We all know what we know, but we don't know what we don't know. And that's the problem. This is a fascinating study. Medical interns spend more time with computers than with patients. This is horrible. 40% of their time spent on computer activities. I mean, are we nuts? We must be. And we're dealing with patients' lives, all right? By the way, money won't cure the problem. This is 2001. IBM, Pfizer, and Microsoft. Can you imagine better companies, more knowledgeable companies, wealthier companies? They got together and they said, we're gonna develop the EHR. We're gonna do it. They put their best brains together. And there's another law of software that I came out with. Law of software number one, the more money you spend on the software, the worse it's gonna turn out. And the reason is that if a surgeon operates a patient in 14 hours, 14 surgeons will not operate on that patient in 1 hour, they'll probably kill the patient. You can't do that with software. Software plays with different rules. Bigger is not better, as you begin to find out. Of course, some people benefited very well, and I don't blame the people who benefited. That's what they do for a living. They're business people. The job of business is to make money, all right? I mean, there's nothing wrong with making money. But we also have a responsibility. I am a physician. And my dream, unfortunately for me, was not to make $1 billion, but to really try to make medicine a little bit easier for all of us. In fact, my patient is you. So let's discuss what the problem is and how do we get here. Now, please let me say that I'm not an expert. And I thank Cheyenne for saying I'm an expert. I practiced medicine, indeed, for 20 years, but I wasn't a great doctor. In fact, I would consider myself below average. I do know programming, but my programmers take me to, I mean, they're 1,000 times better than I am. They laugh at me when I program my Microsoft Word, okay? I'm not a lawyer. I'm gonna talk about medical law today. Are there any attorneys here? Please don't laugh at me, okay? I'm not a businessman, obviously, certainly not like this gentleman here. He's a businessman, all right? But perhaps that is my advantage, because the problem is that we have too many experts knowing one thing, knowing it really well. But we're talking at each other. I know a lot of things, a little bit of a lot of things, and I put them together to look at a bigger picture. Okay, that's my, perhaps my advantage. And that's what I'm gonna share with you today, my vision, which may not be right, by the way, because like all of you, I know what I know, but I don't know what I don't know. So this is me in 1979, and by the way, that's not a real patient, okay? So don't get upset. I got into emergency medicine because back then you could be an idiot and work in an emergency room. In fact, you had to be an idiot to work in an emergency room. I had to get out of LA County Hospital that I went to after Yale because I wanted to have some practical experience, and I got burned out in 1 year in surgery at LA County. And so I went to my director and said, what can I do? I need to take a year off. I said, well, you could work in an emergency room somewhere. And the nurses were my teachers, and they were great teachers, but I was scared to death. Why? Because I didn't know anything. I did my residency later, by the way. So I was really incompetent. So I got very scared, and then I see this ad for a seminar on emergency medicine malpractice. And why was that important? The emergency room, as you know, people go to the emergency room, they used to go to the emergency room for three reasons. Either they were in extreme fear, they were in extreme pain, or they were unconscious and somebody dragged them in. Now, unfortunately, there's a fourth reason that we alluded this morning, is people cannot afford it. Horrible reasons for going to the emergency room. The rapport wasn't there. So nobody was my friend there, and if I made a mistake, I was gonna pay for it, and I was scared. So I took this course in this beautiful resort in Acapulco, given by an emergency physician who was also I turned on the timer, but I don't want to get carried away. How much time have I spoken?
21 minutes.
Okay, great, I'll take 21 from there. Okay, so this course was taught by an emergency physician who was also an attorney. And he spent half his time practicing emergency medicine, half his time suing us. And it was one of the most interesting courses, one that changed my life in a way, and one of the reasons that I'm here today. Because he talked about something that the two or three attorneys that are here know all about, and the rest of us don't know anything about. That's the problem. We all know what we know, but we don't know what we don't know. And of course, you know what res ipsa loquitur is. The thing speaks for itself, and you can see the, you know, you don't need to go to court for that, okay? I mean, that case is settled. You know, the thing speaks for itself. You don't need a medical record. You don't need anything. You lost. And so what this attorneys did is he would put chart after chart of emergency room reports, how we doctors got ourselves into trouble. For example, when we describe extremities grossly intact. And he said, what do you mean, doctor, it's grossly intact? I mean, you didn't really examine it, right? By the way, if nothing happened to the extremity, why did you put it? You don't need it. And if something happens to the extremity, you just admit it that you didn't examine it, right? Et cetera. So as a result of this, back in the 70s, we had a problem. And of course, the problem was malpractice, which by the way has settled now because of the caps. But all of us, actually my predecessors, the generation that was a little bit older than myself, began to chart like crazy. We began to chart like never before in history. In fact, if a doctor from the 30s or 40s, or from another country, by the way, other than Germany and the United States, came to America and saw this, would say, you guys are nuts. I mean, because you can keep the medical records on 3x5 cards, as you all know. But they say that the chart of a nuclear submarine, the manual of a nuclear submarine, weighs more than the submarine. Sometimes the chart of the poor patient weighs more than the patient, okay? And it's all medical legal jargon. And so there was a gentleman whom I met, had the honor to meet, Dr. Larry Wheat, the inventor of the problem-oriented medical record, the SOAP method that we used, that seeing all this insanity in place created an order, because he wanted all of us to write the same way, subjective, objective assessment and plan. And of course we did. But the problem is that increased the time even more. And there is the famous paper in the 60s. The average doctor, and I don't have to tell you, they spends 2.5 hours a day charting. That represents about 15 years of your life wasted, doing nothing but going to an office to write. Are we nuts? We must be. And we think it's normal. And of course, because this became the normal, it became, quote, the standard of care. So Medicare got into it in 1997 and said, if you don't chart it, we won't pay you. Because it's standard of care. It's the way to do it, right? And I don't have to explain to you, to the doctors here, what the EM calls, but that's the biggest insanity of them all, and everyone here, I'm sure, agrees with that. Because they pay you for your thought process. Problem is, the thought process depends on your experience with the case. If I've never seen a case of HIV, I'll be there all morning, but if I have an HIV clinic, the same patient will take me 2 seconds. That's a thought process. But by the way, not only does Big Brother know what the complexity of the case is, but also tells you how to chart it. And by the way, if you don't chart, why should a more complicated case be more complicated to chart? Beats me, Jasper. But if you don't chart it, you don't get paid. Are we nuts? This is costing money, time, effort. How many of you take your charts home? Raise hands. Oh, God. I'm sorry, okay? So, for those of you, how many of you are not doctors? Because those of you who are not doctors may not even understand what I'm talking about, but I will explain it in non-medical terms. I found a way to explain it to non-doctors. Imagine you're driving on a Saturday afternoon at about 40 miles an hour in a busy intersection, right? You got cars on your left, cars on your right, cars crossing over, and suddenly you hit a yellow light and you have to make a diagnosis. Are you gonna speed up or come to a halting start? It's raining, drizzling, right? You have the sun against your eyes. You try to make eye contact with the driver that's coming from the other side, but he's wearing sunglasses so you can't tell if he can see you. You try to look at your rearview mirror to see if there's a car following you. Well, you try to remember how your tires are doing. You see if there's a policeman in the corner who will give you a ticket. While you do all that, you're listening to the radio and thinking of something else. Am I correct on that or not? Now, suppose that I stopped you and I said, okay, will you write all that down? You would waste more time writing than doing it. For most of the cases that we practice in medicine, a doctor will make a diagnosis in less than a minute. Am I right on that or am I wrong on that? And you will spend 5 minutes charting it. We're talking about healthcare costs? We must be crazy. And of course, I brought up the same chart that everybody else did. I'm bringing another picture to the slide. I'm not saying that malpractice and charting is the cause of this, okay? I'm not saying that, but it is definitely one of the factors. But it is a factor that's driving us crazy. So I decided I wanted to do something about it. I began to chart insanely in the emergency room, and I said, this is insane. I mean, I'm a doctor, right? You know, I wanna practice medicine. I don't wanna do this. I mean, am I stupid? I must be. There's gotta be a better way. So I went to South America. I went to Argentina, my country of birth. And I found a group of very brilliant software developers. And I got a group together. I knew nothing about software 20 years ago. And that was fortunate. And I was fortunate that I was doing it in Argentina because I would have gone bankrupt 20 times in a row in the United States. The costs here, I mean, in those days it was, the whole cost of the first year of development with 6 programmers cost me $17,000, all right? That tells you it was doable. Today it doesn't cost $17,000, all right? But it did back then because it was before India, right? It was before globalization. In fact, there was no internet. The CD was stopped by customs for a week and then they charged $5. I still don't know why. But anyways, everybody else was using this, and of course, I don't have to tell you what this is. The doctors in the room, I don't have to tell you what this is. It's an insanity, okay? I don't have to go any further. Why? Well, the theory of the template is good, okay? Here's the theory, all right? There is a correct way to practice medicine, and the template maker knows it better than the doctor who's practicing. That's the theory. Why? Because, I don't know. But let's assume that that's the case. So the doctor who practices looks at the templates and practices good medicine by picking on all the choices. It has many other advantages for the system as well, and everybody who's not a doctor will agree, doctors will not agree, all right? There is even, this is a shootout at the OK Corral, but actually it's a shootout. The experts in computer sciences would have these shootouts, okay, of EMRs with different templates. And a doctor would come in and he would read a typical medical case, a progress note, and then 5 different doctors or 10 different doctors in different EMRs would enter it as quickly as they could, and then they would look at the, you remember that, right? And then they would look at it and they would see which one was the better EMR by how you could enter it, number one, and number two, how fast you could enter it, and that was the best EMR. Let's think about it. When was the last time that a patient walked in with a sheet with his progress note or her progress note, say, hey, please, this is my progress note, let me read it, enter it in the computer? That doesn't happen. In fact, creating the progress note is your job, right? Anyway, that tells you that the people, even well-intentioned people who are not doctors, don't understand what we do for a living. In fact, we don't understand what we do for a living. And because we explain to others what we think we understand what we do for a living, and they create the software, what they hear, they create the insanities that we live in today. So one of the things I want to leave you with today is to rethink what you do for a living, because that's pretty important, communicating to others. And by the way, the reason I'm honored to be here is because I know that you will carry the word to your peers who are not here today, who should be listening to this, but they'll listen to you. Information overload. Misnomer. We are in information underload. The problem is data overload. Big difference. And the formula is very simple. Every doctor understands it. No engineer seems to. Data is everything you see on the screen. Information is only that very small part of the data that you need here and now to make a clinical decision. And everything else is garbage, and you shouldn't be exposed to it, but you are because the engineer doesn't know better, because he's not a doctor or she's not a doctor. So there is all that data driving doctors crazy. That's the second problem, right? And there's even a new disease. I think it's gonna be an ICD-10 because it's not an ICD-9, it's called alert fatigue syndrome from getting all that junk. If I tell you the temperature in the room is 74, I just gave you information, right? But if I tell you the temperature in the room is 23 degrees Celsius, I'm causing problems for most of you. Not because you didn't understand what I said, not because you can't divide by 7, multiply by 9, or going to Google, but because maybe 23 degrees Celsius is not your bag. But if I go back next week to my country and I tell doctors there the temperature in the room is 74 degrees Fahrenheit, I'm gonna get the same quick sick look. And by the way, do I help it if I tell you the temperature in the room is 23 degrees Celsius plus or minus one standard deviation in the fall, or 74 degrees Fahrenheit plus or minus? I'm driving you crazy. All you want is 74. Computers should be able to do that, by the way, if they're programmed properly. Now, this is fascinating. Does anybody know what this is? Yeah, good. Yeah, you're an ophthalmologist? No, okay, you're a psychologist, all right. Okay, great, congratulations. You put a laser beam on the eye. You, first of all, you take the face and you force it into a vise so the face cannot move, and you put a laser beam beaming on the center of the eye, and you can see where the center of the eye is looking at. And what the eye does, the human eye, is saccades, that's the French term, 120 times a minute, because you think you're looking at something. Believe me, you're not. Your center of the eye is jumping on the screen. And what you didn't focus on, you didn't see. And then this occipital part of the brain reconstructs what you think the picture is, which is not the picture, it's what you think the picture is. You see that little red dot there? I put it there. Let's say it's a blemish. Notice that there is no lines next to it. If I ask the person who saw this, was there any blemish there? Oh, no, no. And I said, would you like to take a look again? And immediately you'll see that there's going to be a line going there. Oh, yeah, there's one on the left side. Ha, interesting. Why am I mentioning this? Well, you think you're reading a medical record, right? No, no, no. This is the problem with templates. Would you agree with me that you can speak faster than you can write? Would you agree with me that you can read faster than you can speak? A lot faster. Would you agree with me that you can read your own writing much faster than you can read somebody else's? The reason is this noise versus information. You know, your eyes know where to go when you write it because your syntax is your syntax, and nobody has exactly the same syntax, especially a strange foreigner like me. This is another major problem. Computer people have no problems with this. On the left, you have what is called free text, and I have a poem by Robert Frost, my favorite. And on the right, you have discrete data. The whole computer world wants the stuff on the right because that's why EMRs are around, so they can get data. We talked about that, how to get quality and all that. Everybody except us, we want the stuff on the left because we deal with something called uncertainty and grayness. It's a very strange concept to describe to others. We don't deal with absoluteness, right, in medicine. Now look at what happens when you don't know what you're doing. Now that works. You can put the discrete data inside the fields and records. It drives doctors crazy. So if you're driven crazy by your EMR, this is the reason. Oh, here is a crazy one. There is no such thing as a retrospective query in electronic medical records. Dispel that crazy notion. It doesn't exist. It's an impossibility. Probably there is no such thing as a retrospective query in medicine either, Framingham study notwithstanding. Can I prove it? Absolutely. For you to be able to do a retrospective query, two things are absolutely necessary, and if one of them fails, you can't do it. Number one, the programmer has to be God. Not God-like or Jesus Christ, has to be God herself. Why? Because she has to be omniscient. She has to know every question you're ever gonna ask of that record and has to create a field. If I wanna know how many people in this room have green eyes, all right, there has to be a field for the color of the eyes. And if that, why would the programmer put it there? Because it's God. God knows everything I'm gonna ask. But even assuming that every field existed, every one of those questions has to be answered beforehand, or I'm not gonna get the answer. So every color of the eye has to be measured in the clinic. That's why you can't have a retrospective query, and that's why every retrospective query is truly a prospective query in disguise. Okay, garbage in is equal to garbage out. And this is why our friends in public health should pay attention to what I'm saying, because you're getting garbage. Because all this stuff, the doctor's under tremendous pressure, and he's gotta fill it with crazy stuff, right? And that's what you're getting back. No, 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 that's garbage. That's why it's important for public health. So, garbage, bad decisions, accurate data. Oh, by the way, there is an organization. I'm gonna bag on an organization, the American College of Pathologists. Any pathologists here? I apologize in advance. Okay, so this doctor, Robert Wheeler, fascinating doctor, figured out he was gonna codify every single symptom and every single finding in medicine and every single treatment. Insane, right? Instead of writing English, we're gonna write codification. By the way, that's the code in SNOMED for green eyes. It does exist. Every single thing you can imagine. Thousands of these codes. And he wouldn't have gotten anywhere, except that he went to the American College of Pathologists. And that wouldn't have been anything, except that they're in Chicago. And in Chicago, there's another organization you may have heard of, the American Medical Association. And the American Medical Association wasn't doing too well. In fact, they were losing members like crazy. And then they discovered something called the CPT codes. Have you ever heard of that? Oh, wow. And now they have a swimming pool. I mean, they live like kings. They don't need any members. $147 million a year. You don't need members anymore. So the American College of Pathologists said, oh, Dr. Willis, it's a fascinating thing. And they developed millions of codes. Doctors were not gonna be writing in English, they were writing in SNOMEDese. The federal government, of course, bought it, right? And every foreign government did. Why? Because we need to get discrete data. It's essential. Then, to his great credit, Dr. Wheeler, a very brilliant and honest physician, pathologist, said, you know, I created an insanity. And he made, meanwhile, they flew him all over the world, first class, to give talks like this one. When he told the American College of Pathologists what he really thought, they kicked him out. And so he went to work with Naomi Sager at NYU. They're working on parsing natural language. There's another group at Sunny under Dr. Werner Suster, also trying to parse natural language. And I said, you're wasting your time. Why? Because of the retrospective query. Even if you had it all in normal English, you can't do a retrospective query. You know what you know, but you don't know what you don't know. Common sense? Common sense has nothing to do with knowledge. And then we have the kibitzers. This is the most fascinating part. Kibitz is a Yiddish expression, and I'll read it. It's a verb, to look on and offer and welcome advice, especially in a card game. It's used in chess. Are any chess players around? You know, you're playing chess and then this person walks in and they start telling you how you should play the game. Ruin the game, right? Well, This is how it is. You have the world of providers and you have the world of programmers. They don't understand each other. They're in different worlds. Just like, and this is the problem, okay? They're extraordinary experts in this room. And if we could all share our brains, we would solve the problem of healthcare in 2 minutes. The problem is that we can't share our brains. So we know what we know, but we don't know what we don't know. And it's the same situation. So what was my role? Well, I'm the guy in between. I'm dealing with the schizophrenia. My job is to talk to the programmers in their language. I always say I'm the best doctor among programmers, and I'm the best programmer among doctors. I'm neither a good programmer nor a good doctor, but I can talk the language, all right? And I translate the insanity of medicine into the insanity of programming. And this one, it worked out pretty well, but then all of a sudden a new monster came in. Now, this is insane. So there are two players, right? Those who suffer through the EMR or work with it, those of us who develop it and work for those, and those who neither program the EMR nor use the EMR, but tell us how to do it. Why? Because they're experts, of course, right? Even though I've been doing this for 20 years, what do I know? I'm not an expert. The experts in EMRs are the experts. And they talk the talk. Boy, do they talk the talk. And so that's how these companies got along. And we doctors are also at fault because we said nothing. Nothing. Okay, we were like out to lunch. We let it all happen. We let it happen in healthcare too. We allowed the HMOs to come in. We allowed everything to happen. We just didn't look. We took the ostrich attitude. So we are responsible. When I trained in surgery, Dr. Leonard Rossoff at USC, he was a great surgeon, had a big sign in the, he looked like Grand Central Station. Has anybody ever been in the emergency room at the USC surgery at County? Oh, big sign, gunshot wounds every 20 minutes, and said, not to decide is to decide. And what he, and not to add, do something about this is to do something about it. That's why I admire you guys being here, and I wish everybody did, because you gotta do something, okay? All I'm doing is providing you the information, but you need to do something about the information. All right, so, and then the usability experts. This is the latest monster. I said, guys, if you know about usability, which I agree is the most important thing in the world, why don't you create your own EMR? And then Dr. Long, who's a good friend and a client, said, well, they did. It's called, what's the name, Peter? The EMR that the government created? Vista, right. Yeah. Gosh, if you know all about usability, you're gonna tell us how to develop a usable EMR, create your own. Don't tell me how to do it. I'm only learning from our clients. Our clients are our eyes and ears into the EMR. By the way, it's a humbling experience. You think you know what you're doing, and then your client tells you how much of an idiot you are, and he's right, or she's right. So by learning over 20 years like good wine, you've developed something a little bit better. What do they know? They don't deal with the client problem, don't deal with the EMR. But they're telling us, oh, you know, there's sciences of usability. You can turn it into a science. No, no, if you think so, just develop your own. And then, 2005, January, President Bush read the Riot Act. Hey, we went to the moon, we're gonna have everybody on the EMR. And he was based on a paper by the Institute of Medicine, which is no longer called the Institute of Medicine. What is the name of the new name of the Institute of Medicine? The National Academy of Medicine. And I read the paper. I don't know how many people read that paper on electronic medical records, but it was fascinating. I mean, brilliant doctors on one side, brilliant programmer people on the other. Both made sense, but neither one understood the other. They were talking at each other. And based on that insanity, we created this, all right? And so they called it, they changed the word from electronic medical records, which is the only appropriate word, and I will define why, to electronic healthcare record, because the claim was that the EMR was not just for doctors or for nurses. It was also for all the other, quote, stakeholders, the government, this and the other. By the way, we're gonna pay for it. I'm gonna explain why that theory is wrong, if I have time, hopefully. No, I have about, what, how much time do I have?
1 minute.
1 minute, I don't have time. So, don't take the ostrich attitude. Doctors are now choosing their own EMRs. I'm not going to describe the path of the solution, but I do recommend. How many have you read this book, by the way? It's an amazing book. We need to change the paradigm, okay? By the way, what they've done with EMRs is turned in all the bad paper record into a typewriter with a paper record. Computers are metaphors, okay? Now, this is what software looks like. There are no components in software. That's a metaphor that our minds use. You take a little card at the bottom, the whole edifice comes down. There are companies in India that will actually sell us any component we want to pass meaningful use or anything else. Problem is they don't talk to each other. Well, I'm not gonna get too technical, all right? I'm not gonna go on any of that. I'll be happy to go, but I did wanna talk about this. The purpose of the computer, if you ask me what's the most important thing about the computer, is the interface, all right? What is an interface? It's the ability to do your own thing at your own time, in your own way, and let the world get what they want at their own time, in their own way. So the EMR is an interface for the provider and their staff. I'm sure that the federal government will have their own software, patients can have their own software, insurance companies have great software, public health can have their own software. The software is for the providers and their staff. And by the way, the doctor should be able to write, the patient has green eyes, and the software translates into that garbage of SNOMED or whatever else they want, and the doctor doesn't have to deal with that, because that's noise. And of course, let's not forget about what Dr. Atul Gawande did. Are you familiar with the Checklist Manifesto? It was a bestseller. You can use the EMR in ways that you cannot think about. I mean, it's not just about charting, it's about using it as a checklist to think on how to improve, provided that you write it yourself and not some expert that tells you how to do it with a template. I'm not gonna describe our solution, I don't think it's appropriate. If anybody wants to know, I'll talk to them later, but we know what we know, but we don't know what we don't know. So, the EMR is a critical medical tool, not a computer thing. Providers should select it, learn to use it well, and provide feedback to the vendor. Others should have some software that caters to their own field, and the government should focus solely on rules of interoperability, interfacing, and never on usability on how we develop the EMR. The best way to predict the future is to invent it. And by the way, not just for me, but for all of you. Thank you very much.